In 2020, our city will celebrate its bicentennial. Hello, I'm Brad Bobian, Planning Administrator for the Department of Metropolitan Development at the City of Indianapolis, Marion County. As we approach that milestone, I'd like to share with you some thoughts about the challenges and opportunities facing our community, as well as an unprecedented planning effort known as Plan 2020.
In this presentation, I'd like to first talk conceptually about the history of development in our city county. I'll then back that story up with some real numbers before leading into some thoughts on the future of planning in our city and wrap everything together by introducing Plan 2020, an unprecedented planning effort we're undertaking. Now imagine for a minute two cities. Here is Indianapolis, Marion County. There is a generic Midwestern peer city we might compare ourselves to. Think Cleveland, Cincinnati, Detroit, or St. Louis. We start off way back in the late 1800s when our cities represented here with the red box were settled. Fast forward a few more decades, as both here and there grow, you see the city growing with more population, the green arrows up top. But also some growth starting to occur outside the city limits as roads, streetcars, and interurban rail lines were developed. Forward a few more decades to the post-war era, and both here and there are thriving with growing populations. However, things were beginning to change. The federal government was investing heavily in highway infrastructure, making it easier to move around regions. And they were also getting heavily involved in promoting home ownership by getting into the mortgage business, putting a new home within reach of millions of new households. This combination of subsidized highway construction and subsidized mortgages was leading to a boom in new subdivisions on the edges of cities. Here we did something few others did. We did Unigov, merging the city and county in a very progressive embrace of regionalism. Our city limits grew. Now, as a side note, I want to put that step into perspective. Here, Marion County is shown in white, overlaid on top of a few of our peer cities and a few others. Unigov created an enormous city. Not counting the excluded cities, Indianapolis is 373 square miles. If you include them, it's 403. You could fit three Atlantas or Detroits inside of Marion County, five Cincinnatis or Clevelands, almost two Chicagos. New York City is only 20% bigger. LA is just over a third bigger. In most other cities, places like Castleton, Mars Hill, Nora, Crooked Creek, Irvington, and Holmcroft are independent suburbs. Here, they're all part of our city. Back to our story. Post-war, that suburbanization wave begins to take its toll on there, as most growth begins occurring outside of the red box, outside the city limits. Population begins to peak and flatline. Here you see the exact same growth pattern happening, but because we expanded our city boundaries, that suburban growth is occurring inside our boundaries, so population continues to grow. That same trend continues, except now the central city begins to lose population. There, the city population begins shrinking. Here, our central core is also shrinking, but it's disguised by Unigov. Move that into the 1990s, same thing happening. And that brings us to today. Marion County is substantially built out. Yes, we still have some open land on our fringes, especially in the southern townships. But just like right before Unigov, the bulk of development and population growth is now occurring outside the city boundaries. And just like our peer cities did in the 1960s, we're beginning to see a peak. The lesson of the story is that while Unigov bought us 40 years of population and economic growth, it did not change the underlying development patterns of our city, and it may have actually blinded us to that reality. So now it's time to back that story up with some real numbers. This is population of the Indianapolis region over the past 90 years, using the current Census Bureau definition of the Indianapolis Metropolitan Statistical Area. The orange areas are the townships in Marion County, while the green ones are the regional counties. You can see the steady growth in Marion County up into the 60s, and the relative non-growth in the regional counties up until that point. They remained largely agricultural communities. Marion County actually lost population in the 70s and has steady but tepid growth since then. The regional counties, on the other hand, have exploded in growth, particularly after 1990. But look at Center Township. Remember how here disguised the same development patterns happening there through Unigov? Well, since 1950, Center Township has lost 58% of its population. Our Center City declined just like it did there. Now let's zoom in to the past decade. The trend hasn't really changed. Despite the huge residential growth downtown, the revitalization of lots of historic districts, and significant redevelopment efforts in places like Fall Creek Place, Center Township has lost another 18% of its population. And you even are starting to see bleed in Washington Township. We still have fairly rapid growth in the southern part of the county where there is still undeveloped land, but as that land fills up, you'll see those numbers decrease quickly. Now let's start talking about who lives here. This chart shows the differences in who is living in Marion County versus who is living in the broader region by income. Marion County has a disproportionately higher number of households earning less than $50,000 per year, and a disproportionately lower number of households earning more than that. And then you look at the flows of those households in and out of Marion County. This chart shows the net migration by income. So at a given level, some households move out of Marion County to a regional county, and some move from a regional county into Marion County. This chart shows the net. So you can see at the very lowest income bracket, Marion County had more people at that level move in than move out. And once you get to households earning $25,000 a year, we have more households moving out than we have moving in. Now we add in migration from elsewhere in Indiana, shown in red, and elsewhere in the nation, shown in blue. When that migration from outside the region is taken into account, Marion County does a little better with the middle class, but the pattern is pretty much the same for the upper income households. So to sum up that income story, the orange line here shows Marion County's share of the regional population. As growth occurs outside the county, you would expect our share to decline. The green line represents Marion County's share of total regional income. You can see in 1970 we actually had more than our share of income, but since 1980 our share of income has decreased faster than our share of population. Our population share has decreased by 18%, while our share of income has decreased by 27%. Long story short, the income is moving out of the county. Let's take a look at another way to view who's living here. This is Marion County's relative share of different age groups compared to the region. You see there are really three different groups of ages where we have greater numbers compared to the region: kids under 5, millennials, and seniors over age 75. Now take a look at those four largest red bars. They're linked. These are families. Once kids hit school age, we lose them and their families to the regional counties. And once those families are out there, most really don't come back. Now the millennials represent a huge opportunity. Nationally, this group loves cities and abhors suburbs. We'll have to see what happens when they have kids, but just looking at these numbers, this is an important demographic to the future of our city because we outperform the suburbs with them. And I want to note that people often ask me why we'll be any different than any of their cities I talked about. If we just bought ourselves 40 years and were where they were at the 60s, what's different? The difference is the demographic tide is on our side. There's a global convergence of millennials and empty nesters preferring cities over suburbs. We have to seize that opportunity. And just to hammer home the fact that most growth is now occurring outside of Indianapolis, this chart shows Marion County's share of regional building permits in green and our share of total value of investment for those building permits in orange. You can see 20 years ago we had 40% of development. Today we have just under 10%. The other side to that new development coin is what's happening to the old development. That shows up in vacant and abandoned homes. In the 70s, both Marion County and the region had a vacancy rate just over 6%. Today, both rates are higher, but ours is about 2% higher than the region's. But Marion County is far from irrelevant and nowhere near done. We have 1% of the land in the state of Indiana, but are home to 14% of its population and 19% of its jobs. And if you focus on downtown only, despite taking up 0.07% of Indiana's land, it's home to 4% of the jobs in the entire state. Nowhere is anyone close to that. Marion County remains an economic gorilla. We're home to 65% of all jobs in the region. Hamilton County is a distant second with only 13%. But remember how more and more people are living outside the county? Well, more and more, we're becoming an employment zoo, where people come in during the day to look at the economic gorilla that we are and then leave at night. More than 205,000 people make that drive every single day. That's more than a third of all the jobs in the county. Now, having jobs is great, but from a public finance perspective, we incur a net loss from all of these commuters. First, we plow the streets, fill the potholes, and provide police and fire service for all of those jobs. Second, those commuters obviously do not live in Marion County, so we miss out on the property taxes that they pay to their home county. And third, because in Indiana, you pay income taxes based entirely on where you live, not where you work, we don't get any of that revenue. And more, we're in a regional property tax abatement game where we don't even get the property tax revenue from their employers. Now, yes, all of these commuters buy gas and eat lunch while they're here in town, so it's not a complete loss. But for the most part, we derive very little public benefit from more than a third of the jobs present in our county. Now, that is important because local government lives off of property and income taxes. They're what we eat to stay alive. In fact, 83% of our budget comes from those two sources. And in the post-property tax cap world, property tax revenue is essentially flat. Between 2010 and estimates for 2013 and 14, there's less than a 2.5% annual fluctuation in property tax revenue. But income taxes are down. Note that 2013 and 14 are estimates, and if you've been following estimates at the state level, their projections are coming in lower than anticipated. So I would anticipate similar things happening locally. Now, Marion County still has some headroom in our income tax rate. We could raise it, but you see our current rate is already 62% higher than some of our neighbors. Raising them may generate more money in the short run, but in the long term, it doesn't really help with our problem of higher tax-paying households leaving our county. The sum of the story is we've lost revenue, between 6 and 11% drop over the past few years, almost entirely due to a drop in income taxes. You might write that off as a product of the Great Recession, and while it's true that incomes dropped everywhere, think back to who's living in Marion County. More and more, it's lower income households, and that means lower income tax revenues. Our problem is not cyclical, it's structural based on changing demographics. That drop in revenue means we're missing out on some opportunities. This year, 92% of our local budget is spent on safety and justice. Police, jails, probation, fire, courts, prosecutors, public defenders. 8% is left for everything else. For the things people who don't get in trouble use. Streets, sidewalks, parks, quality of life stuff. Now, it's not that public safety has been growing exponentially. We all know public safety is as underfunded as anyone. It's just that the pie is shrinking, and we try not to shrink public safety. So the result is public safety eats more and more of the pie. A piece of the pie that's now completely gone is the city's investment in planning. This year, my department, Metropolitan Development, which is responsible for planning and zoning for the entire county, receives $0 of the local budget. We're entirely reliant on fees brought in from development review and federal grant dollars. We're also exhausting our savings accounts this year. And when you look at those federal grant dollars over the past two decades, the trend is clear. We've lost nearly $4 million in real dollars, and if you adjust that for inflation, it's more like $10. We're treading on thin ice. To sum it up, I'd like to make three points. The first is that most growth is now occurring outside of Marion County. We're largely in redevelopment mode, and redevelopment is never cheaper, financially, politically, or socially, than development in the cornfields. Next, higher income earners continue to leave the county and take the higher income taxes with them. The result is that we face a structural, not a cyclical deficit, and the more quality of life aspects of our city we cut, the more incentive we give people to leave the county. Now, I won't get into state and federal policy, but suffice it to say that both levels of government have struggled to balance the need for disproportionate investments in the economic engines of cities with the politics of representative government. The big lesson here is that tax-based decline is really bad. But tax-based decline isn't a problem. It's a symptom. The problem is, yes, public policy at the state and federal level is stacked against us. That's not going to change anytime soon, and while it's important to keep working on, it's not going to let us hire cops or fill potholes this year. The problem is we as a community are not competing for residents. Most people don't choose to live in one town or another. They balance what they can afford with the quality of life they desire. They look for good schools, safe streets, friendly neighbors, nice amenities. And whether that's at 86th Street or 106th Street isn't in the forefront of their minds. Part of the competition problem is we're not in the game, and if we're not in the game, we can't win. Subdivision builders have welcome centers. They have websites and folders full of information about what's nearby, the quality of the schools, and the neighborhood amenities. They have relationships with HR departments and real estate agents to share that information. Nobody does that for existing neighborhoods. You have more school choice living at 22nd and Central than you do at 116th Street and I-69, but there's nobody to tell you that because you're on your own. The other side of that goes back to Unigov. The bulk of Marion County is a suburb, competing with newer suburbs across the county line. Except they don't have sidewalks and trails. They don't have neighborhood clubhouses and pools. The roofs and furnaces of the houses aren't brand new. The reality is we compete very well downtown. If you want to live in a bustling urban center, you have to live in downtown Indianapolis. If you want to live in a single-family home or two-story apartment building, you have lots of options, and we need to do a better job making those places in our county competitive. The other side of the problem relates to jobs. We're a very blue-collar town. We buy a lot of Ford F-150s, and the most popular music format in town is country music. No style judgment here at all, but those things are both very blue-collar. We've lost a lot of those blue-collar jobs and haven't replaced them very well. And we haven't done a very good job growing our current workforce for new jobs that we are more successful at attracting. To address tax-based decline, we have to compete for the people to live in Marion County, as well as grow opportunity for those who are already here. So that leads me to the future of city planning. I believe we have three themes going forward that I'll elaborate on. City planning must be more coordinated, more relevant, and more strategic. First is coordinated. I mentioned how we have zero local dollars going into the Department of Metropolitan Development this year, and the declining federal grants that help us operate. We're now down to five people in DMD responsible for long-range planning. To put that in perspective, San Francisco has about 10% of the land area we cover, about 80% of the population we have, but they have 40 people, 10 times more, dedicated to long-range planning. So we can't do what we've done in the past and have to ask ourselves some hard questions. What do we have to do? What really needs to be done? What do we do really well, and what might others be able to do with us? So while there are only five of us, the reality is that city planning is no longer centralized and really hasn't been for quite some time. There are dozens of organizations out there that do city planning. I've listed just a few here, but peer agencies here at the city like DPW and Indy Parks, state entities like NDOT, private entities like utility companies, nonprofit groups like the Local Initiative Support Corporation and neighborhood-based groups. The list goes on. So knowing that every one of these groups loses when we don't compete, we all need to recognize our shared interest in creating a competitive city. And that means coordinating and connecting all of these partners to leverage the total planning capacity that we have. A first step in that effort is the creation of the Marion County Planning Consortium. For the first time, all of those groups will be getting together on a regular basis to talk. It's important. Now on to being relevant, and I'll start with a story here. I was part of a coalition presenting ideas for public art and greenways and placemaking to a pretty high-profile committee in town. Everyone generally bought into the idea until one person raised his hand and asked how these things would help people in a neighborhood that are struggling to put food on their table, or living in a house with a leaking roof, and where they have their kids sleep in the basement at night to avoid stray bullets. It got me thinking about Maslow's hierarchy of human need from high school psychology class. The gist of Maslow's hierarchy is that people are at different levels of our pyramid, and until their needs at that level of the pyramid are satisfied, they really don't spend much time focusing on the needs of the higher levels. I think we generally recognize that it's hard to focus on learning when you haven't had a meal in 3 days, and that it's hard to pay much attention to the newest local restaurant when you've just been laid off and have no job security. I started thinking that maybe there's something similar for neighborhoods. A pyramid probably isn't the right shape because it implies the top and bottom are good and bad. And it doesn't mean everyone in a neighborhood has the same needs. But there are some neighborhoods that really need help feeding their families, finding a job they can live on, and keeping those stray bullets at bay. There are other neighborhoods that need more parks and greenways and public art. Now, it's very important to note that I'm not saying any neighborhood deserves or values different things at all. I want to be crystal clear on this. It's not a question of worth or value. Every citizen of the city deserves all of it. But is putting a nice new streetscape or great new piece of public art into a neighborhood where people are facing high unemployment or are suffering from hunger really being relevant to their needs? Perhaps those things are relevant and part of a bigger strategy. But perhaps those things are what we know at one level of the Maslow's hierarchy, and we're assuming they're of relevancy to people at different levels. I think too often we have a one-size-fits-all solution that may or may not be relevant, but usually distracts us from meeting people's real needs. And to put another spin on the issue of relevancy, I'll bring back the graphic of Marion County overlaid on top of the city limits of other cities. We are an incredibly diverse city. You can farm in Marion County, and you can work in a 50-story office building. We have dense urban neighborhoods, sprawling suburban areas, and rural agrarian areas. Even if you don't buy into the Maslow hierarchy observation, we have to be relevant to the different types of places that make up Marion County. So I believe we need to collectively come up with different response packages, complete with different roles for different players based on the neighborhood type or need. There may be places where I, as a city government planner, can play an important role. There may be places where others can play that role. The point is, we need solutions that are relevant to different types of neighborhoods' different needs. Finally, I believe we have to be able to know what's going on in our neighborhoods and districts. We need near real-time data that shows us how a neighborhood is doing. We need to be able to pinpoint right when a neighborhood starts to do this, starts to change its trajectory, and craft a response packages that changes that neighborhood trajectory. We can't wait until neighborhood bottoms out. It is exponentially more difficult and expensive to kick the can down the road and wait for that to happen. And that brings me to Plan 2020. Now, we know we need to make our city more competitive. We know we need to grow our tax base. We need to do a better job coordinating our collective planning capacity. We need to be more relevant to our diverse city, and we have to be more strategic in what we do. We also have a need to update some of our core city plans, as well as to update and create others to compete for some federal investment. It's also our city's bicentennial in 2020, and that gives us a chance to take a deep breath and think about what the next chapter of our city looks like. This is what Plan 2020 is all about. Plan 2020 is a strategic planning process to both envision and engineer a city that works for our next century. Plan 2020 is led by the Greater Indianapolis Progress Committee, a nonprofit group of dedicated civic and corporate leaders long invested in shaping of the city. The Department of Metropolitan Development is working alongside GIPSI as a partner to update core public policy. There are two ways Plan 2020 is conceptually organized. First is that public policy, a suite of city government plans. This element is led by DMD and outline what city government can do or support. The plans include the Comprehensive Land Use Plan, which establishes policies for how we use, preserve, develop, and redevelopment all land in the county. The Marion County Thoroughfare Plan establishes policies regarding the multimodal transportation network for all major streets and corridors in the county. The Indianapolis Regional Center Plan promotes the sustained growth of Indiana's economic engine, the downtown core. The Consolidated Plan outlines community development strategies that promote prosperous neighborhoods and is required by the Federal Department of Housing and Urban Development to receive funding. And finally, we're kickstarting a regional planning effort known as the Community Economic Development Strategy, or CEDS. This is a multi-county plan that positions central Indiana as competitive in the global economy and is required by the Federal Economic Development Administration to receive funding. There may be another plan or two added to the suite, but this coordinated update of all these plans together is unprecedented. They're normally done in silos at different points in time. For the first time, they'll talk to each other. The other organization is really the thought creation of how we want our city to be in the future. This will be led by GIPSI and be the core framework by which Plan 2020 engages the community and drives the value propositions we make to our residents. These themes are bigger than the blue bars of city planning, but we'll include them, a point I'll get to in a second. But the themes are Live Indy, focused on building a great place to live, choices for housing, neighborhoods, schools, parks, your place-based daily life. Connect Indy will focus on the physical and digital connectivity that ties our city together. Work Indy will focus on building employment opportunities, choices for jobs, entrepreneurship, and pursuit of passions. Love Indy will focus on building a city you love, a place you have an emotional attachment to, in much the same way people say they love Paris or love San Francisco. This includes culture, fun, entertainment, and beauty. And finally, is Serve Indy, that recognizes a core strength we have is that whether it's to host the best Super Bowl in history or to build an amazing public hospital, we can come together as a community and get things done. The beauty is how the city plans and thought themes weave together into a strategy tapestry. Imagine a network of new industrial parks along I-70 coming out as a strategy from the Work Indy process. From the city plans, you might see this strategy reflected by the land use plan proposing a change in land use around key interchanges where these industrial clusters might go. The thoroughfare plan might propose street improvements to facilitate the truck traffic they need. The HUD consolidated plan might propose investments in job training activities to support these parks, and it might show up as a core element of the regional economic development strategy. Similarly, you'd be able to pull up a single plan and see elements of each theme represented to varying degrees in each plan. The cornerstone to Old City Hall, where we'll be running this process out of, has a quote that says, "I am myself a citizen of no mean city." Mean here, meaning average, not angry. Well, we're preparing no average plan for no average city. First, our adopted plans will be different. In particular, the land use plan will be a truly unified document that covers the entire county. Right now, it's more than 200 different documents proposing more than 200 types of different land uses. We'll also be broadening them beyond simple land use to include performance indicators that help us both evaluate and implement the plan. The thoroughfare plan currently addresses only the needs of cars. The new plan will be multimodal and incorporate all the transit, bike, and pedestrian networks that we have and need to build to compete. Our consultants will have one eye on funding, so the plan isn't just a pipe dream. And we'll incorporate street design, not just traffic flow, into the plan to recognize streets serve both a transportation and a value creation purpose. The adopted plans will also be different. The Red Thought creation themes will produce a broad community vision that will involve lots of different players to implement. Our city plans will be what we as a city-county government can do or can support. Adopting plans that we have no intention or even ability to implement is misleading and demoralizing to residents. We're going to be honest that city government can't do everything, and we will be transparent in telling you what we can do. The funding for Plan 2020 is different. It's a mix of philanthropic and public investment, both for the plan itself and for the venue of Old City Hall. And speaking of Old City Hall, we're bringing it back to life, rechristened as The Hall. We pay to maintain the building anyway, and thanks to the support of the City County Council, we're going to put it back to use. It's a beautiful building, and thanks to the work of nonprofit People for Urban Progress, we have some very cool digs full of creatively repurposed furnishings to do our work. Our team will be different. We'll have a mix of city staff and consultants working on the city plans, contract support helping drive the thought creation, and a small army of students in a new long-term internship program we're branding CityCores. CityCores allows students to work on the plans with our staff, serve a Marion County nonprofit organization, and learn about issues facing our city. We have a very different and very aggressive timeline. While each plan is moving on a different treadmill, our goal is to have a solid draft complete by the end of this year, using next year to vet the plans, refine them, and go through the adoption processes. Our planning process itself will be different. We'll be having fewer meetings, but more events, more public education, and more interaction. And we can do this because we're not starting from scratch. We're more about knitting together lots of recent plans and ongoing initiatives into a coordinated framework than we are about brand new ideas. Those are important and will come, but we're relying on all of the public engagement and professional thought that's gone into existing things, rather than asking the same questions to the same people all over again. And finally, our product will be different. I'm not sure what it will look like, to be honest, but we're committed to have less of a printed document that's immediately outdated as soon as we print it, and trying to find ways to make our work more digital, more easily updated, and more shareable. We've got some great minds coming alongside us to think through this, and I'm really excited about the possibilities.
So that's Plan 2020. We need you to get involved. Keep in touch and follow our progress online at plan2020.com. Together, we can build a city for the next century.